Hey, Pastor Steve Waldron here, New Life Pentecostal Church, Albany, Georgia. Hope you're doing great today in Jesus. We're going to look at biblical inspiration. Man, the Bible is under attack. It's under attack by science. It's under attack by history. It's under attack by archaeology. And it's even under attack by supposed Bible believers. People who are supposed to believe the Bible, they're biting it. Things that 10 years ago would have been called atheism are now in mainstream evangelicalism. Shocking to me. So, and that's what belief in evolution does, is believes in progressivism, that there's no core truth, that everything is in flux. Whereas we know that there is core truth. The church is the pillar and ground of the truth and all this. So let's go to 1 Chronicles 29:19. 1 Chronicles 29 and 19. I'm just going to read these to you. You can follow along. 1 Chronicles 29 and 19. And the Bible gives so many internal evidences of its truth and validity and what it thinks of preservation and inspiration. So let's look at this. And given to Solomon my son, this is David obviously praying, a perfect heart to keep thy commandments, thy testimonies, and thy statutes, and to do all these things and to build the palace for the which I have made provision. So David is praying. He said, God, I want Solomon to do this. Give him a perfect heart to keep thy commandments. Well, these obviously were given by Moses some 500 years anterior to this. So obviously they would have had to have been preserved, correct? Yeah, because how could he keep them if he didn't have them? Remember, all the kings are supposed to write themselves out a copy of the law. But it doesn't just a perfect heart to keep thy commandments, thy testimonies. And so this would have been the acts of God. This would have been the book of Judges, you know, the book of Joshua and conquest, as well as the Pentateuch. And thy statutes, and to do all these things. Notice, and to do all of them. Well, if they weren't preserved, he couldn't do them all. Now, could he? So, obviously, you've got a 500-year period of perfect preservation of the Word of God, that Solomon was supposed to know these things. And then Ezekiel 24:14. Let's look. So the Bible is just replete with all of these internal understandings of Scripture. Ezekiel 24:14. And it says this, I, the Lord, have spoken it. It shall come to pass, and I will do it. I will not go back, neither will I spare, neither will I repent. According to thy ways and according to thy doings shall they judge thee, saith the Lord. So God says, I've spoken it, and it shall come to pass. Shall. Not, and I'm going to lose it, and nobody's going to know what was said, and nobody's going to have a copy, and we're going to be trying to constantly reconstruct it, and nobody's ever going to know for sure. It shall come to pass. I will do it. I will not go back. Just another sign of inspiration. I've got me some more notes. Yeah, this Bible's seen its better days. Hallelujah. I just need a glue gun, glue it back together, and it's not Humpty Dumpty. Let's go to Daniel 10:21. Daniel 10:21. On inspiration. This is an angel talking to Daniel, and he says, but I will show thee that which is noted in the scripture of truth, and there is none that holdeth with me in these things but Michael your prince. So the angel knew scripture. Why? Because it was forever settled in heaven. So angels know the Bible. But I will show thee that which is noted in the scripture of truth. This is not just a history book. This is from the mind of God to the mind of people. So angels can show that which is noted in the scripture of truth. 1 Thessalonians 2:13. This is going to deal with inspiration. 1 Thessalonians 2:13. I hope to write a book on this, on Create Space. Okay. Okay, for this cause also thank we God without ceasing, because when you received the word of God, which you heard of us, you received it not as the word of men. There's none of this stupid incarnational inspiration garbage that's going around, even Pentecostal circles. you didn't receive it as the word of men, but as it is in truth, the word of God, which effectually worketh also in you that believe. The oracles of God, it's called in Romans. Another one of these videos I've done on inspiration. So you didn't receive it as the word of men. You received it as the word of God. I feel sorry for preachers and people trying to read this as the word of men. It's the word of God. Believe the internal testimony of itself. Acts 1:16 says this. Acts 1:16. It says, "Men and brethren, this scripture must needs have been fulfilled, which the Holy Ghost by the mouth of David spake before concerning Judas, which was guide to them that took Jesus." Notice process of inspiration. First of all, notice that they know the scripture was talking about Judas. And so it says in Luke 24 that Jesus opened their minds. He opened their eyes and revealed to him, to them, himself in all the scriptures, in Moses, in the prophets, not the Deuteronomist, in the prophets, can I get an amen, and in the Psalms, in David. So not the Deuteronomist, but so not just that, the Holy Ghost by the mouth of David spoke. Remember in 1 Peter 1:10-12, it says the Spirit of Christ that was in them spoke. Holy Ghost, what's the Spirit of Christ? Holy Ghost, you got it. You believe in only one God. I'm glad. But that's not even the main point I'm trying to make here. That how inspiration came when he was writing this from Psalm 41:9, I believe it is, somewhere in that neighborhood. This is not a reference Bible. I'm trying to do that by memory. Which the Holy Ghost by the mouth of David spake. So David spoke it, and he either wrote it as he spoke it, or a secretary wrote it down perfectly because God preserved his word. The Holy Ghost spoke by the mouth of David. That is inspiration. Now let's go to Acts 8:28-30. Acts 8:28-30. This is Philip with an Ethiopian eunuch. So, and was returning and sitting in his chariot, read Isaiah the prophet. He didn't read 2 Isaiah. He didn't read that which was lost. He read Isaiah the prophet. Verse 30, "And Philip ran thither to him and heard him read the prophet." Not anything else but the prophet Isaiah, and said, "Understandest thou what thou readest?" And he said, "Well, how can I except some man should guide me?" That means teachers in the church. The place in scripture he read was this: "He was led as a sheep to the slaughter, and like a lamb dumb before a shearer, so opened he not his mouth. In his humiliation his judgment was taken away. Who shall declare his generation? For his life is taken from the earth." Notice that is not 2 Isaiah. That is Isaiah the prophet. And the Ethiopian eunuch had a copy, showing that copies of scripture weren't confined to Jerusalem. They were in synagogues all around the world, and they were even in Ethiopia, and they were readily available before the printing press because there were people called scribes that Jesus talked about. Okay, so get a biblical view of scripture. Okay, Acts 13:27. Acts 13:27, and there's so much of this, I don't even have time to go into it all. Acts 13:27, "For they that dwell at Jerusalem and their rulers, because they knew him not, nor yet the voices of the prophets which are read every Sabbath day, they have fulfilled them in condemning." Not the Deuteronomists, the prophets. First book of Samuel, second book of Samuel. That means Samuel and the school of the prophets that he had. This was not the Deuteronomist coming in 500 years later. Read the Bible. You say, well, they were just, that's what they assume. So they're lying. Paul was stupid. You know more than Paul. Congratulations. No, this was inspired too. Okay. The voices of the prophets. So when you read Chronicles, when you read Kings, when you read Samuel, when you read Hosea, you're hearing the voice of the prophet. That's what you're hearing. It may be a translated voice, but it's still the voice of the prophet. And they're read every Sabbath day. Okay, last but not least for this time, Deuteronomy 4:2. We'll do a few verses in Deuteronomy 4. Deuteronomy 4:2. It says, "Ye shall not add unto the word which I command you, neither shall you diminish aught from it, that you may keep the commandments of the Lord your God which I command you." Oh no, they polished it up. You don't even understand, Brother Waldron, that first of all, Moses, I mean, he used oral histories and oral traditions in writing this. There's no answer. It was written by man, not God. Remember, you received it not as it was the word of men, but as it was in truth, the word of God in 1 Thessalonians 2. And of course they polished it up. No, don't diminish a word. This was a commandment. And they were never rebuked for changing the word of God. Paul said that they were blessed because unto them the oracles of God. Josephus said they'd rather die than change one letter. I wish there were some Christians like that alive today. Okay, verse 4, Deuteronomy 4:4. He said, well, we got the Holy Ghost and the message still works. The message still works, you're right. Well, we know from history. Well, history, how do you know history's right? You're just opening up everything when you do away with the Bible. Preach the word. People are going everywhere to hear the word. Verse 4, but ye that did cleave unto the Lord your God are alive, every one of you this day. Behold, I have taught you statutes and judgments, even as the Lord my God commanded me, that you should do so in the land whither you go to possess it. Keep therefore and do them. So keep, it's a command, preserve them. And this is your wisdom and your understanding. What? The Bible, the commandments, is your wisdom and your understanding in the sight of the nations which shall hear all these statutes and say, surely this great nation is a wise and understanding people. This idiotic garbage Peter Enns is putting out there saying, well, the Israelites just copied the code of Hammurabi and they copied, it was an ancient Near Eastern document, and they're all about the same. Liar, not true. The Bible, I'm going to stick with the Bible. You can stick with your Harvard degree if you want. That is a lie. What you write in your books, it's a lie. And Satan's father of lies. You need to repent. Okay? That these, and any apostolics that are believing that garbage need to repent, because it's a sin, it's demonic, it's evil. Satan attacking the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, that they'll say, no, these are better than their laws and their understanding. This is better. The Bible is better than theirs. And they'll say, what a great nation in their wise and understanding. So it's not congruent. Can I get an amen in Jesus' name? Hallelujah. Let's go to verse 8. And what nation is there so great that has statutes and judgments so righteous as all this law which I set before you this day? Moses is writing it then. I'm setting it before you right now. And there's no other nation that has anything like the Bible. So you're not a Christian if you believe what Peter N. says. Yeah, I say I am. No, you're not. Because you can't believe what I just read and believe all that other garbage. So God bless you. I love you. And I love you enough to tell you the truth. And the truth will make you free. God bless. I love you in Jesus' name.